This week's Dreamland represents a change in tone and direction for Dreamland. We are going to be concentrating on the experience and those who understand the experience and who can help us get more deeply engaged in our contact with the visitors. We will be talking to Matthew Roberts, the author of Initiated, who was on the Roosevelt during the Gimbel UFO incident, and Terry Lovelace will be with him. We will be talking shortly to George Knapp and Jeremy Corbell, who have their fingers on quite a few things that are just at the edge of the known, in a sense. Danny Sheehan, the famous attorney who has been so deeply involved in this from the beginning, will be with us, and many others. As the public becomes more and more aware of this reality, it's up to us to deepen and intensify and expand our own understanding and our levels of contact. Because as time goes on, we are going to become more and more engaged in this whole process in many different ways. Unknown Country and Dreamland will continue to be a place where the presence is directly involved with us through our communication with each other and with those who come on the shows on unknowncountry.com. This week's show will be audio only because of technical issues. There's sometimes the video feed is difficult to set up, and this week happens to be one of those times. But get set for what is truly going to be a memorable Dreamland with Grant Cameron, who is deeply engaged in this, not only as a UFO investigator in the classic nuts and bolts level of this, but so much more.
This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to be talking to one of the legendary UFO investigators, legendary in a good way. Grant Cameron has been working in this field for more than 40 years, at least as long as I have been in it. And unlike me, Grant wasn't dragged into it by the hair on his head. He came into it because he was interested. And we're not going to be doing video today because the video system failed, and I don't know why. I don't care why, but anyway, we're going to be doing this on audio. Welcome to Dreamland, Grant Cameron.
Thank you, Whitley. It's an honor to be on and to share with you, because I think you're one of the key people that people in the world should be listening to.
Well, you are also, and let's start by talking about a little bit about the 60 Minutes broadcast that took place on I believe it was the 16th of May. Which was a breakthrough in one sense. For 50 years, 60 Minutes has been on the air, and for 50 years, they have not covered this subject. Now they're covering it. And I think that as much as the New York Times and the Washington Post now with 60 Minutes, something has changed for the public. And what do you think the future is likely to hold? I think you might have even some pretty specific information about that.
Yeah, well, my impression of the 60 Minutes thing was, and you've done a lot of stuff with media people, and I have as well. Sometimes I feel sorry for the guy who's doing the media story, as you know, you got to start the whole thing by, you know, spelling out UFO for the guy, because he's never done anything like this before. He has no clue what, you know, he's been given the assignment or whatever. So a lot of these big media things are sort of a balanced affair. They've got, you know, somebody who's sort of pro and somebody's against, and they put some videos in and stuff like that. And it was intended for the general public, not really so much for you and I, the stuff that was on there was all very sort of old stuff, except for the woman, which was kind of interesting. The female pilot, I'd heard about her because this leaked off of Mellon's website probably 3 years ago or 4 years ago. Her name was on there and all this kind of stuff. And she described this incident of the object. When they first saw the object, it was above the water and it was bouncing around like a ping pong ball, like an insect flying around inside a box or something like that. And the weird thing was, you said that that's how I got started. I had a sighting in 1975. There was a small town where they said, you know, this thing was flying around. They call it Charlie Red Star, and it was there all the time. And I said to my friends, I said, you know, instead of driving around the big city, let's go out to this town and see what's going on. And we didn't go for 3 months. We said, yeah, we'll go. And we never went. And then the local TV station caught this thing jumping off the ground, and it went viral in the city where I live, Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada. And so then we went out, and we were in the town for an hour and driving around and stuff like that. And there was nothing happening. It was like, you know, you buy the lottery ticket, you know, the chance you can win, but you're not going to see anything. Everybody else sees it. You're not going to see anything. And my friend said, let's go back into the town one more time, and if we don't see anything, let's go home. I said, fantastic. It's been a total waste of time. We turned to go back into the town, and the thing flew in front of the car, and it was not a light in the sky. It was an object real low in front of the car. No doubt about what it was. It was just the most bizarre thing I'd ever seen in my life. But two nights later, I dragged all my friends out there. And the second night, when we were waiting for this thing to come, I looked on the horizon and there was this flash. And then one of the kids, I had taken some kids that were doing science fair projects. They're about 14 years old. And they were in the field and they said, is that what it is? And I'm looking at that. Didn't look what I saw the first night. I said, yeah, I guess so. And then it flashed, flashed, and it was flashing. And it was exactly what they described on the 60 Minutes event. This thing was jumping around the sky. We called it the bouncing ping pong ball. And it was all over the place. And we just went, wow. And it's just jump. It was all over the place. And the thing is, why would a UFO do that? What, you know, is that a pre-abduction maneuver? Or like, it's just crazy. I mean, to me, it's what I call the theory of wow, which I've talked about quite a bit, where I believe that a lot of what the intelligence is doing, it's just making us go, wow. So when I heard the female pilot talk about this, and Fravers talked about this as well, how unbelievable this was. This thing was bouncing around, jumping all over the place, and that there was something under the water. And so to me, I sort of laugh and I say, you know, the intelligence probably said, you know, Zogar, go under the water, make some big bubbles. Here they come, you know. And they just set up this thing, and there's a V formation coming in from the side, which most people haven't talked about. There was all sorts of them on the radar, and they'd been seen for a week, and they were around and this sort of thing. So the thing was impressive in that way, and but still these things always have a situation where it's a sort of a new reporter doing it. Now in the future, what you're seeing, like in the morning, they had the other one. I can't remember which station had done one of the big TV networks had done a UFO thing in the morning, and it was the old thing, you know, laugh, 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 chuckle, chuckle, all the, you know, the Star Wars music and all this kind of stuff. And people were really upset about that when I was talking. And so what I had done after the thing was I put a panel together. And I called it the 60 Minutes UFO post-game show. So let's get all these researchers on. And I had about 11 researchers on there. And just their impression. And basically everybody had the same impression. It was like when James Fox did his thing. There was all this material. It was all very interesting. It was all very well put together. But it was, for a UFO researcher, it was basically the same old stuff. And like Danny Sheehan came on, and Danny Sheehan was sort of the highlight of the whole thing. When he got going about what was actually happening in the background, he called it a nothing burger and, you know, sort of laughed. You know, it was the same old thing. So that was the thing with the 60 Minutes. But it does move what they'll say is it was not intended for you and I. Same as the New York Times article, which is what shifted the whole thing. It was the New York Times, but actually the New York Times was only part of it. People always say the New York Times broke the story, and I always say no, it was not New York Times. It was New York Times, Washington Post, and Politico all went the same day with the same story. Now, they didn't have as elaborate a story, but they all had got these sources that were confirming that there was this ATIP program. So there were three newspapers which indicated that this was all planned, that this rollout. And so I've done some podcasts where I've talked about this rollout, where I say it actually started back in the Obama days with Hillary Clinton. That Hillary Clinton goes on the Kimmel show in May of 2016, and she says, you know, they're not called UFOs anymore. They're not called UAPs. That's the new nomenclature. Well, how would she know that in May of 2016? Because she was behind this. It was John Podesta and her, and they were pushing, and John had made her make a promise, and she was pushing it up because in 2016, I wrote a book called Managing Magic, which came out in February of 2017. This is 8 months before the New York Times story broke, before Elizondo appeared, before Jim Semivan. I identified Jim Semivan in that book. I said they are going to drop this thing. They were going to drop it in 2016. In fact, I was told in 2016 by my – I had a couple sources, but my key source said the big man is going on 60 Minutes. So this 60-minute thing was going to be done in 2016, and the guy they were going to put on then was not Lou Elizondo. It was going to be Jim Semivan was going to go on. And what I was told in 2016 was a number of high-level government officials are going to come public, and they are going to drop the UFO story. This is exactly what happened.
Right.
Justice Elizondo, Jim Semivan, Chris Mellon, all these high-level guys. I was told this in 2016, and it's in my copyrighted book, February of 2017, exactly what is happening now. I was told it was going to happen. And what happened was that Hillary lost the election. So once Hillary lost the election, then they had to rework things. And the other thing that happened was that the three key officials that were helping Tom DeLonge and Podesta unroll this thing were McKay, the General McKay from Air Force, McCaslin, General McCaslin, and Robert Weiss from Lockheed Skunk Works. But they were all outed by the WikiLeaks. When John Podesta's emails all became public,
right,
then suddenly it was identified that these three high-level officials were helping unravel this thing. In fact, McCaslin had actually, if you look at the WikiLeaks emails, he'd actually wrote a memo as to what the White House should do once the story started to break. And he talked about, you know, NASA putting out a press release and all this kind of stuff. So this has been in the works, I would say, for at least since 2015. And it took them a while because of this, the WikiLeaks thing, Hillary losing the election, and they had to rework the thing. They had to replace Weiss and all these guys with different people. And so I'm not surprised. They're doing a very good job at it. My impression is that it's all well planned, and Lou Elizondo has said that. There's a plan that they're unraveling. That's what I was told in 2016. And they're moving the ball down the field. Now, my big fear is always the thing about the threat. So if they're going to move it out to get you and I to know what's going on, but if you look at what's going on, there's always this fact that the military may play this thing as a threat, or the military-industrial complex, and move it back into the black world. Because if you look at what's happened now, what do we really know? We know they briefed the Senate. So what did they say? Well, you know, we really can't say. And then I was involved, and this is in the last couple of months, I was involved, the Canadians were briefed by the people on whoever's behind this were briefed. I was brought in as an advisor to the Canadian government people because they had no idea. It's the old diet. They have no idea what's going on or who's who. So I was brought in to explain this is this guy, bring them up to speed on what UFOs are about and this sort of stuff. And so when the meetings took place, there was two, one with the Canadian ambassador and there was one with some parliamentary people from the opposition party. And when I asked them, I said, you know, so what happened? They really wouldn't tell me. They didn't tell me anything. And I was on the thing, so I had no idea. I knew when the briefings took place. Maybe wouldn't be briefings, unofficial briefings. But I was not told anything. So that's my problem is that if they're going to bring it out for you and I to figure out what's going on, and they're going to tell us what's going on. But if it's just simply for you and I to vote and put pressure on congressmen in order to get some money for them to take it and make weapons out of it, then I got a problem. Because if you look at what they've done, who have they briefed in the Senate? They didn't. Why did they not brief the Senate Science and Technology Committee? Why did they not brief the Outer Space Committee? Who did they brief? Intelligence Committee and Armed Services, which is weapon stuff, and that's the part that scares me. So we'll see. We'll see where it goes. They've got it. I think they've probably already got the money. It's all sort of going the way they want it to go, and very carefully controlled, very well orchestrated plan. But I say it's been going on for at least 5 years.
Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a brief break right now. Stay with us, and subscribers will just keep right on keeping on.
Listen to some words from one of our longtime subscribers.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Some of the most thrilling, mind-opening interviews ever recorded are in the Dreamland Archive. Open your mind to Sir Lawrence Gardner's brilliant vision of the past. Listen to Russell Targ's phenomenal insights about ESP. Be inspired by Dr. Eben Alexander's stunning near-death experience. Listen to an actual recording from a plane as it was attacked by a gigantic flying disc. Be transported to a new level of inner grace with Whitley Strieber's meditations. Enjoy The Communion, Transformation, Majestic, Secret School, and Superstorm audiobooks, and so much more. The UnknownCountry.com subscriber section. As little as 10 cents a day. Priceless.
My most recent three books, Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision, are a series designed to lead to a rich and useful experience of contact for us. Afterlife Revolution starts the series by showing that what we call the dead still exist and can and will become part of our lives as companions and teachers of a whole new kind. A New World's central theme is about the relationship between us and the presence, which includes our visitors, our dead, and other aspects of consciousness that we perhaps cannot describe in words. It discusses the deepest meaning of communion between us and them. It is frank about the dangers and plain-spoken about the methods. The third book, Jesus, A New Vision, is there for people who are not involved with religion, and for those who are, too, of course, so that they can gain access to the teaching of Jesus about how to live with and for the good, for it is living in this way, as an ally of the good, that we can form our relationship with our visitors into something valuable to us. If you have not read all three books, I urge you now to get the ones you haven't read, listen to them on audio, read them on Kindle or in paper form, however you prefer. They are part of our way forward, each of them in its own way. We're talking to Grant Cameron, one of the world's premier UFO investigators, and we are discussing, we're going to go very much deeper because, like me, Grant has gone way beyond the nuts and bolts aspect of this whole business. And we're in a situation where primarily the intelligence and military sides of the Senate in terms of Senate committees are the only ones being briefed on this matter, which means that if the briefing occurs in later in June, the report is submitted later in June, and I have my doubts because, speaking of Danny Sheehan, Danny was here at my house a couple days ago, and we spent a lot of time together with his friend Mark Sims, and also a Dreamlander, and we were discussing whether or not they would be asking for a continuance, and they may. And if they do that, it will mean to me that they are behind the scenes, which they have an absolute right to do, invoking the part of the National Security Act that gives them the authority to not to keep things classified that they don't have answers to. In other words, if they don't know whether or not something is a threat, they have the legal right to keep it under wraps. So we'll see what happens later in June. That's really up in the air in my mind.
Yeah, now, I can comment on that because Danny talked about that. We did an interview with Danny just after the show ended, and he talked about the continuance as well, that the idea is to get a continuance so there's no time limit, and then hope that, like he, as he described it, the war in between the Palestinians and Israel takes over the scene and everybody forgets about it. But I don't think people are going to forget about this. And the other problem they've got now is Danny is meeting tomorrow with the Department of Defense Intelligence Inspector General, and there are actually three complaints filed. And the problem they got now is it's not you and I and the public. Now it's Danny Sheehan. And
right.
As you know, Danny Sheehan had the Pentagon Papers. He exposed the Iran-Contra thing. Harvard University thought they could walk around him. They're now up against Danny Sheehan. And Danny Sheehan knows every trick in the book. And
right.
I asked him about the Inspector General. I said, because one of the panelists was complaining, he was a military guy. He said, well, the inspector general, they're always sweeping stuff under the carpet. So I said to Danny, I said, do you think, because you're meeting with these guys, and he said there's three different departments that are dealing with the three different complaints that they have forward, and he's going to meet with all three one at a time, and then with the head of the head inspector, and he doesn't really know, but I asked him, can you keep these guys in control? Can you actually force them? And he said, well, we'll see what happens. But Danny Sheehan is the best thing that has ever happened to the UFO field in terms of dealing with this, because Danny Sheehan, as Harvard University thought they're going to walk around him, and they suddenly realized, like, you know, they're up against somebody who knows all the tricks and who is not been fooled by the games that are played in Washington. Danny's been there. He was in the, you know, did the Carter administration thing where they were doing the reports for Jimmy Carter and this sort of stuff. He's been around. He knows all the games, and he was really, when we interviewed him, he actually was getting pretty angry. He was pretty getting fired up that he feels like this is his moment, that he's on stage now and he's going to play the game. And as you know, Danny Sheehan, there's no way they're going to walk around Danny Sheehan.
Well, you know, I'll tell you a little bit about my meeting with Danny. It was very interesting because I had a period of missing time about 2 hours before he and Mark Sims arrived at the house. Wow. Now, that's unusual. I don't have those often. The last one I can remember, and I would hasten to add, it's possible that they're so seamless that it's possible that I have them from time to time and don't remember them. But the last one I remember having was after a wedding in Seattle, where I was with some people, some of the few people still alive who have any really even indirect knowledge of the biology that's who are outside of the classified world. And I had a missing time period of 45 minutes at the airport on my way into L.A. After I got off the airplane in L.A. Now, this other missing time experience happened this way. I was making my lunch. Danny and Mark were going to arrive later in the afternoon. I was making my lunch, and I opened the refrigerator, looked in the refrigerator to see what I could find. Didn't find much, and closed the refrigerator, and the power went out. It's 12:02. Now, I had a Zoom meeting with some friends in a few minutes, so I thought, oh, I'll have to do the Zoom meeting on the phone. Then the power came back on again. And the microwave oven and the other oven and some other non-battery-powered clocks were all flashing 12:02. But here's the problem. It was now 12:24.
Wow.
I had been gone for 22 minutes. I have no memory whatsoever of that. But then when Danny and Mark showed up, I was like pre-programmed. And I had all kinds of things to tell them that I never, ever, ever talk about. And I was astonished at this. It was unbelievable. But it happened. And, you know, we had a lot of other things to talk about that are more or less on the table already about the relationship between what's going on now and what eventually will happen with the abduction phenomenon and so forth. And we touched on the concern about chemical abductions that have been induced by the intelligence community or the military, et cetera, and all kinds of things like that. But so that was very unusual, because that process of missing time has been demonstrated to me. And I know how it works. It uses sound. But whoever came in here was very stealthy, so stealthy, because it's a small apartment. If someone had come in the front door, I would have heard him, but I didn't hear a thing. And my kitchen is an open kitchen, and it's 10 feet from the front door, and the front door makes a lot of noise when you unlock it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So whatever happened was anomalous, and that means that somebody at another level of reality was interested enough in this to sit me down, which I'm sure they must have done, and go over with me everything they wanted me to say. So,
yeah. Yeah, that's true. That's where I think there may be other aspects that we sort of leave out. Because I had we're talking about contact modalities. I had a download in 2017 where they were sort of saying to me, okay, is the world made out of little nuts and bolts? If it is, well, that's one world. But if it's made out of consciousness, that's a completely different world, and all the rules change. Is it one life? If it's one life, that's one world and has certain rules and regulations. But if it's multiple lives, then everything changes. All the rules change. And so that's where I look at sometimes we look at it as sort of normal, everyday stuff, and we don't realize that there may be all sorts of other aspects playing into this. And it, like, for example, the number of these high-level people who may have be experiencers.
Right.
We mentioned Jim Semivan. I was told, and Jim Semivan does state in his in Tom DeLonge's first, where he writes, I think maybe it's the second book, he writes the foreword, and he talks about the fact that he has this encounter, and doesn't get into any details, but he said it absolutely shattered my view of reality.
Right.
And Gary Nolan, who does the all the DNA stuff, talks about the experience. He seems to be pretty clear an experiencer. And the other one is Tyler D, who is in American Cosmic. I mean,
right.
I had an encounter with him in 2013, and he told me this idea about, when he had this big invention, this medical thing that came to his head. He said, you know, Grant, I woke up in the morning. So the last thing I remember the night before was a hooded figure standing at the end of the bed. And I said, oh, could you see its face? And he said, no, I couldn't see its face. And then I said, you should be regressed. You should go to Von Smith and be regressed because he's always in L.A. And so you see these patterns that it may be more complex than just a one nuts and bolts world, that we may have made agreements coming in here, and that the intelligence is helping orchestrate this discovery thing, or this unraveling of what's going on. Because if you look at in the 1890s, they were flying around in wooden ships with the propellers on them, and then they moved to like Foo Fighters, little balls of light, and then there were green fireballs, and then there were Adamski crafts with balls under them, and then suddenly there was the ships with the windows, and now there's triangles, and every time you look, the tic-tac appears, and you haven't seen a tic-tac since 2004, and I've had two incidents myself where like the one with the flashing, where this ball was flashing around. When it finally got there, it was a totally different object as it came in closer. I've had that twice, where the object actually changed from one object to another as it came into my field of vision. So it's the whole idea that we got to realize that it may be a much more complex world, that there are the intelligence or the visitors or whoever behind the scenes that are helping to orchestrate, to unravel this thing, because I think they're doing the same thing. That's why I say, I call it the theory of wow. When you start looking at all the UFO stuff, like, why do you need to bounce around in the sky? Why do you need to do zigzags? Why do you need to leave crop circles? And why do you all this kind of stuff? And it's like to make you to go, wow, the world is not what I think it is. And
right.
Make you start thinking, because they can't come in and do our homework. They can't come in and tell us what's going on. They, as Jim Semivan said, and this is according to Chris Bledsoe's son, he said, I was in a room with Jim Semivan, and Jim Semivan said, these are ultra-terrestrials. They created us. And they are talking to us through symbols. And that's my impression, that it's not a direct thing. They can't interfere. Or what I was told about the Canadians in the 1950s. And I asked Danny Sheen about this. But in the 1950s, the Canadians claimed their message they were getting from a being by the name of AFA. That was dealing with a Canadian, the top guy, Wilbert Smith, said, AFA had said, we will never, ever interfere unless there's a nuclear exchange, and then we will step in. And we can do it, and we can prove that we can do it. We can take the moon in front of the entire world, split it in half, put it back together in front of the entire world to show that we can stop a nuclear exchange. Other than that, we will allow the human race to stew in its own juices. And that's this idea of the non-intervention, that we are here, we have to learn our own lessons, they can't come in. And, you know, it's like we sort of do it. We head into another country, and it's like, we're here to bring you freedom, democracy, Jesus, and McDonald's. And, you know, people are pointing guns and telling you to get out. And it's this idea. But I think indirectly, and we may have made an agreement, you and I may have made an agreement before we were born in some sort of thing with the beings to play the role, that we came in and said, okay, it's going to be a tough role or whatever. And so people will always complain about their experience in the UFO thing, and I always remind them, I say, just remember that if reincarnation is a fact, then you and I probably agreed to come in at this particular time, at this particular place, in the whatever mess we see ourselves in, and perhaps we came for a reason.
Well, you know something? It occurs to me, I have a kind of big idea here. It has to do with all of us researchers, all of us experiencers, all of us, you know what we are? We are Sancho Panza to the government's Don Quixote. And Don Quixote is not listening to us any more than he did to Sancho Panza. Yeah. I think that sums it up, man. I think that's what we are.
Yeah. And that's why I think we have to listen to the experiencers, because people are always interested in, you know, when's disclosure coming? What's the government know? And it's like, and I was even given a message, and I don't know if it came from some intelligence or whatever, but they said to me, they said, so when disclosure comes, so what are you going to do? Y'all going back to church? And that's the whole thing, is this thing's going to be like a spiritual type thing where people are going to realize, like, oh, my goodness, there's all this underlying stuff about dead people and other worlds and stuff like that. And people sort of want just the entertainment value. But what I say is, if you start talking to the experiencers, the people who are interacting with the phenomena, then you start to learn what's actually going on and get the message. Whereas a large portion of the UFO community still will not listen to experiences. It's like, oh, that's just anecdotal, as if the story of a UFO sighting is an anecdotal. It's all anecdotal. It's
well,
all
anecdote means a single instance. There's a lot of anecdotes out there. Yeah. Well, you know, they have to face the fact that if you look at these UAPs, and I understand the reason for changing the nomenclature, unidentified aerial phenomena is actually better nomenclature than unidentified flying object, because we don't know if they're even objects. That's really true.
But what I think is, because they did it once before, and that was in 1952, they changed it from flying saucers and flying discs to UFO. And that was done by Ruppel from the U.S. Air Force. And the Canadian government guy, Wilbert Smith, never used the word UFO. He always used flying saucer. And I think he knew already, because with this, one of the problems with it is that you can change it. And you can say, yeah, we can believe in UAPs, but that really doesn't mean that there's anything paranormal to this. It may still be military. And it's to avoid the question of what is this actually, what are we actually talking to? And,
right.
So that's my problem with it.
Well, when you see listen to the stories that were told on 60 Minutes, you realize that the idea that there's somebody sitting in these things and, you know, that they're going to come out of them isn't not proven by any means. I mean, simply the behavior of the objects is a cross between mechanical and, as you said yourself, something like the motions of an insect. And that's been my experience. I've seen things that were both mechanical and seemingly alive. I mean, I've walked up to one that used to come to my cabin, and then quite a few people got rides in. But when you walked up to it, it was like a living thing. It was like walking up to a person. It was just incredibly strange.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, I've lost my train of thought, so just go to the next.
Oh, that's good. Good. We'll take a break right now, then. We're free Dreamlanders. Become subscribers. This is becoming so important. And if I lose, I am not like most people at my age comfortably off at all. I have been beaten up and beaten up and beaten up. I can't even get a publisher. I have to publish my own books now, not because there's a conspiracy against me, but because I don't sell books. My books don't sell very much. So please help. Get on the stick and subscribe to unknowncountry.com and listen to these wonderful commercials, and especially the one about the book about Jesus, because this is the direction we're going to go in if we're going to win this. We'll be right back.
Contact in the Desert 2021. The journey continues.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds. The fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of
our species, how we came to be here, and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
Contact in the Desert 2021 goes virtual. Go to contactinthedesert.com to find out more.
We're talking to Grant Cameron. The best way to find Grant Cameron, Google Grant Cameron, and you're going to find Grant Cameron in a whole lot of places. His website as of today, and this is May the 18th, 2021, we're going to be running this, I think, this weekend or next weekend. I'm not sure which. His website is under construction, but he's got a great YouTube presence, my friends. Do not miss Grant Cameron on YouTube. Okay, Grant. Now, let's go on, and we're going to kind of circle back in a funny way to what Jim Semivan said and the implications of that. I thought when I heard that he had been originally targeted to be the one who would go on 60 Minutes and so forth, and then that didn't happen, I thought to myself, that's probably because he had a close encounter, and they are not ready, and I don't blame them. I agree with them completely to get the close encounter material into the wider public space, because that is, you know, they don't understand that. They're not even close in the military and the intelligence community, and they don't know how to deal with it. But there's something more there. It changed Jim Semivan's life, as it has changed the lives of most of the people who have experienced it. So what's the real direction here? It's not nuts and bolts, and they're not enemies with highly advanced weapons that are going to come here and turn us to powder. Because if they were going to invade us on that level, that would have happened in 1947. It would have taken 5 minutes and be over.
Yeah.
So let's go a little deeper.
Yeah, the Semivan thing, the way I look at this thing, because I've dealt indirectly with people around him for many years now, and it's the idea, and I think it's a story you originally told about Rockefeller and Bill Clinton when they were at the ranch, where Bill Clinton tells them the story about the tar baby. And it's this idea that the tar baby, if you touch it, it gets stuck to you. And if you're the president, you cannot touch this subject. Now, I think it's the same
that's exactly what Lawrence Rockefeller said. He said,
yeah, and I think that's the same thing with Jim Semivan, because what I heard, and this is a story I heard, that when Jim had the experience with the beings, he had gone to guy at the CIA who runs the weird desk and said, "I need to know. I had an experience last night. I need to know." And he said, "You don't have a need to know." He said, "I don't have a need to know. Tell you what, you bring your boss's boss in here." This is what I was told by a close friend. You bring your boss's boss in here, and we'll see who doesn't have a need to know. So they bring in, I heard it was the director, CIA director, and he said, "Leave it alone. Don't touch it. I remember the words. Pretend it's a one-off. Pretend it'll never happen again. This will ruin your career." And then what I heard is when he left, that's when they gave him the briefing as to what's going on. So this is the impression I got, and Kit Green talks about the same thing, that when you're in the government, you really don't have that high a security clearance, but when you leave and go into contractor, then you get the security clearance. So you have this situation where I think a lot of them may have experienced, even there's even a thing I found in Jacques Vallée's book last night, where Hal Puthoff's son has right after the Phoenix Lights, in July of that year, Hal Puthoff's son has a daylight encounter with a triangle craft coming across, and Hal makes the comment, he said, this is weird how this works. He said, I started by picking up George Adamski's book and got absolutely swept up in this whole thing, even though I realized the book was total garbage, and believed that it was not random that he picked up Adamski's book in the 1950s. And that's when you get into this thing is everything happening seamlessly the way we think it is in a nuts and bolts world, or is there all these other things that are interacting? And that's why I always found it so important when you mentioned this thing about Anne. Anne says, I'm no longer Anne, but I'll always be Anne to you. And that's my impression is, I say we are not the character on the stage. We think we came here, and we're the character on the stage. We are not. We are playing an actor on the stage, and on a stage, and that's a big difference. So you come in, you play this role, and that all you've got to realize that there may be more than just what's happening now with synchronicities, all this kind of sort of stuff. You start to realize maybe this is all sort of pre-planned, and a lot we're getting some help from the intelligence, because the intelligence is doing a lot of stuff, but they're not being very direct about it. They're being covering up the same as the government, and it may be the same thing the government's using, the same program that the intelligence is using. Is that they're using the breadcrumbs. They're just making us think, they're putting out little bits and pieces, and they've been doing it for many years, and it's up to us to figure it out, because if they come and tell us, we're just going to revolt against it and not believe it.
Well, yeah, because it's such an incredible leap from where most people are with this now. Where the general public is now is, I think, probably pretty much where 60 Minutes and the Times and the Post and now the View, I think, had a show on it, is taking them, which is that there's a mystery here, and it's a real mystery, which is a good place for them to be. I mean, I think it's a very good place to start. It's just, to me, it's a very solid thing. But what worries me is the concentration in the interaction with the elected officials on those who are concerned with the intelligence aspect of it and the military aspect of it. And I always think to myself, do they know something that they're not telling us about this? And of course, if you look at the abduction stories, some of them are terribly harsh. And mine was it. I mean, my God, it took me, it was 20 years of pain, not continuous pain, but off and on pain severe enough to take me to the doctor to treat the injury in the scarring in my rectum from that event. And I'm not alone. I mean, a lot of people have had very hard times with this. I don't see how they could come out and say, well, people have a very hard time with this, and we don't know what it is, and we can't understand it. We can't do anything about it. I think that maybe they're trying to find some way of controlling it, not necessarily fighting it, but at least that they can say, well, we have this device which we can use, and it will prevent them from, or it will reveal them or something. What do you think of that?
Well, the trying part, when I do contact modalities, I talk about that. It's not only UFO experiences that have it. It's, for example, and this is the idea, is what's happening in our life random, or are we planning this kind of stuff? Because if a psychic comes to you and says, Whitley, tomorrow you're going to have a car accident, you have a car accident, then you got to really start to think, I mean, did this time and space exist? Like, was this planned? I mean, do we have free will, all this kind of stuff? And when you start looking at the experience thing, the trying, a lot of experiences, their first one is very trying, and then if you go to the pre-survey, they'll say, I mean, if you could stop this, would you stop it? 83% say, no, just keep it going. And you get used to it, you go along, and it's the same thing happens in near-death experience. Like, the contact modality of being abducted is very close to the contact experience of near-death experience. And a lot of people, I had the one woman who had the vision, she was given the vision that everything is absolutely perfect. Well, she was thrown off a motorcycle, face first into the concrete, and lost her face 50 years ago. And so near-death experiences, do we plan the near-death experience? Is God really evil that he's making us go through these near-death experiences? Because you come out with all this knowledge, or the psychedelic experience, or you see a lot of the contact modalities, and I list over 70 when I research them, is that they have this area of trauma. Like, people get a fever, a real high fever when they're a kid or have a near-death experience or something, and suddenly they become psychic. Or a lot of mediums have childhood abuse issues where they're trying to shut out the physical world, and all of a sudden they're talking to their dead grandmother. And it's that ripping of the veil. And that's why I say, I always make this joke about the aliens. Like, why does it come into the room and wake you up and go, wake up, wake up, wake up. And then you wake up and go, oh, my God, there's a horrible-looking alien in my room. It's got to be the scariest thing in the world. And then what do? They say, put your head on the pillow and go back to sleep. And then I ask the people, say, what do you do? Well, I pulled the covers over my head and went back to sleep. Well, that's the last thing you would do. So why would the intelligence wake you up just to put you back to sleep again? And it's this disassociation thing that you see over and over again in contact modalities, where you have to rip the veil, you have to force the person to dissociate, and then you can go into the field. Because my idea in the whole contact modalities is, and Ray Hernandez had this as well, is that all the information is in the field. If you take the Edgar Mitchell survey, it says that at one point during their experience, they knew the answer to everything in the universe. In near-death experiences, it's 31% of people say, during my near-death experience, I knew the answer to everything in the universe, which gives the indication that all the answers are in the universe, and it's the ability to access the material, to bring it over, where you get musicians who say, oh, I had a dream, Paul McCartney with this yesterday. It was in a dream. I had the whole thing. It came into my head. I got on the piano. I played it, and I went around. I thought somebody else had played it. It's that idea that you get into the field and bring it back, which is very important for the intelligence, which means the people say, oh, they're here, they're studying us. Like the one guy was talking about this plane that was going back and forth along the coast, and every day he would see the military plane, they would see the UFOs or whatever, and they're spying on us, they're gathering material. Well, if they can give you in the field access to everything in the universe, I don't think they really need to do any analysis as to where you're going. They can go to your cap point as they did in the Nimitz thing, where you're intending to go. I think they have a tremendous amount of power, tremendous amount of knowledge as to what's going on, and it's this gradual leaking of the material, whereas we think it's just the standard world where it's nuts and bolts. But when you start looking at the experiences and you start listening to them and you say, oh, the wall opened up and the beings came through, or I have this one from Israel, very interesting guy, who got the oneness is the main message, the oneness experience, where he the beings are in his room in L.A., he now lives in Israel, but they were there, and he said when they leave, they were green beings. They looked like grays, except they were completely green. And when they left, they held hands, and they made a circle, and they started swirling around in the circle, went faster and faster and faster, and they became translucent, same as Mark Sims describes. His being was translucent, sparkling, and then the ball, it turned into a ball of light and got smaller, 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 and it just the ball of light disappeared. And it's that kind of stuff that I think the government really doesn't want people to know, because they have no clue whatsoever how to do it. And it's so easy to go into fear. Well, people say, oh, you know, this fear thing, you're supposed to be protecting us, and they can't protect us because they have no clue. They know, yeah, this phenomena is real. They know this is existing, and that's why they you hear these stories that they're looking at people like Chris Bledsoe, or if you've read Peniston's book, they come to get his DNA and you did that for them. So he goes to get their DNA and the fMRI, and then Peniston says, okay, Green, you're not leaving. I'm going to find out what the heck you're doing here. Like, what are you doing? Like, what do you need my stuff for? I'm not like Burroughs. I'm not going to roll over. Like, what are you doing? And he said, well, it's kind of like propulsion. And then Peniston said, what do you mean propulsion? I'm not stupid. Don't tell me it's propulsion. And he said, well, it's kind of like we're trying to figure out how do they move interdimensionally? How do they pop in and pop out of our environment? And that's the thing. They're looking at, they know this really weird aspect, but they're looking at experiences, because you're not going to get it by looking at lights in the sky or all the stuff that they're doing. That's where we're still in this game, where we're going to get some money from the government, and then we're going to do analysis, and we're going to do all count how many green ones and how many red ones and how many fast ones and slow ones. No, you've got to talk to the people who are actually interacting with them. And unlike the government, the experiencers, if the experiencer trusts you, they will tell you everything that happens. It's not the government. It's like, you don't have a need to know or whatever. They're going to tell you, and you start getting these things of the – what I asked Danny Sheehan, because he said that Lou Elizondo didn't buy into the fear. And I didn't realize that. I thought he was promoting this fear thing where we know we need to start another war, this weapons of mass destruction nonsense. And then Sheehan said, no, he doesn't. And he was actually warning him, Lou, if that's not your message, you better not be telling the message. You're going to get yourself in a box with this fear thing. And that's the thing. It's much more complex that there's these messages that were being given, and the government has no control over what it is. And even Jim Semivan said that. I had heard there was a higher-level person who had gone to Jim Semivan and said, Jim, I need to know who's running the show here. And he's talking about the government. And then Jim said, they are. And that's what I think, correct.
Realize. They are.
They're running the show.
They have
no control. And if you're the government, like the president of the United States, he's like the top guy in the world. He's the most powerful guy in the world. And you protect him. That's why Bill Clinton said it's like the tar baby story. The president cannot touch this story because he can't answer the questions. He's supposed to know all the answers. He's supposed to be the most powerful guy in the world.
Right.
He can't stand up and say, we have no clue what they're doing. We have no clue what's happening here. And that's where they don't want to go, but they still want to go for the technology because they're getting technology off this. And that's the other part of the cover-up that I say is going on. Not just the government not knowing. It's the people inside this invisible college who are getting patents. Because you know and I know that there are a couple of them who have made some big money on this thing.
Oh, so yes. If you're on the leading edge, indeed.
Yeah, if you're on the leading edge, you're not going to release what you've got. You're going to say, oh, I can't because I'm afraid I'm going to be outed or am I going to lose my job or whatever. But you know everybody's trying to file a patent. Because if this technology is what we think it is, I mean, this is worth billions and billions and billions of dollars. Even like Jacques Vallée talked about the guy that got the metallic stuff on that's used on discs and stuff like that, and the dreams that he got and stuff like that, and how much money they made from one little invention. People don't realize. So if you got this. And you're getting medical inventions like Tyler D. You know Tyler D. You have a contact modality where you do the sensing thing.
Right.
He has this contact modality where he says, I never drink alcohol. I never drink coffee. I sleep for 8 hours. Then I get up for an hour. Then I go back to bed for an hour. Then I get a tall glass of water. And I go sit in the sun. And then the intelligence starts to talk to me. That's Tyler D. And so he's using this contact modality where you can tap into it. But he's got 40 patents, and I can guarantee you there are a lot of other people in there who are not going to release anything until they've got a patent and a way to make money. Because that's what it's all about in this world, modern world. It's about making money.
We're taking another break here, folks. Free Dreamlanders, listen up. And everyone, get out there. Go on Amazon or wherever it is you buy books and get into Grant Cameron's work. Contact Modalities, The Keys to the Universe, is the latest book. And if you sense in this interview that there is some incredible depth to Grant's understanding of what's going on, you're absolutely right. And it is time to start really seriously studying this and integrating it into your life. When we get back, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to be talking a little bit about Tyler and his methods, and especially why he would choose to sit in the light of the sun. We'll be right back.
Support UnknownCountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
We're talking to Grant Cameron. You can easily find Grant Cameron by simply Googling the words Grant Cameron. You will find him in many places, and as I said before, his YouTube stuff is fabulous. Don't miss it. It's filled with the same kind of wisdom and depth of knowledge that you're hearing in this, what I regard as an absolutely marvelous and very enlightening interview, and I'm so grateful to you for it, Grant. Now, let's talk a little bit. I don't know if you know Tyler well, but I know Tyler quite well. We've been friends for a while, and there. I wish I could say some of the things that have happened between us because it's been interesting. Let me put it that way. And there will come a time, folks, when I can feel comfortable doing that. But right now, he's like many of the people in the outer rung of this. Inside the inner world, there are rungs. On the outer rung, there are names that you know, the names that we've been discussing today. And then just below that, there are people we know of, but we don't know their real names. That's where Tyler is. And then below that, you get into people who have direct contact with the visitors. Some of them know it and some of them don't. But this is where policy starts. And it starts, this is when Grant said earlier, they are in control. Jim Semivan was told, that's correct. And this is the level where they are functional, because this is the level where there are people who can interact with them. And I don't mean sitting across a table. It ain't like that. I mean that can respond accurately to their communications. And some of those people are in the military and called intuitives. Others are in different parts of the government, and some of them are outside of the government entirely and doing this kind of work. So that's kind of where we are. But let's go on and talk a little bit about why you think Tyler would want to start his day by engaging in an experience of sunlight.
I'm not even sure. I noticed the technique he uses, and people learn different modalities. For example, Gary Nolan has a different modality, and he's the guy that the DNA stuff was at one time with TTSA, is not anymore, but is working with Kit Green on this experiencer study. And he talks about his. He said, and this is this thing where it's all the same thing. We're always parsing it. It's like you separate the psychic people from the remote viewing people and the ET people, and it's all the same thing.
All so right.
He said, I don't know how it works, but I know how to make it work. And he used what Wilbur Smith and a lot of people do, is you work through a problem as much as you can, and then you write it down, the questions you got. And he puts them down beside his bed. And he said, I wake up, and it's either in my head that day or within the next couple of days.
Yeah.
And that's this idea of how do you get in the field? How do you use, and it's the modalities, the different ways that people do it. So Tyler's using his modality. But a couple of interesting things I can mention about Tyler, that because I've had two contacts with him, and he was very close with Chris Bledsoe, because he's following Chris Bledsoe. That's the whole idea. Why has Chris Bledsoe got this very high level of contact? What's he doing and stuff like that? And they're watching it. And a couple of the interesting stories were, if you've ever interviewed Ryan Bledsoe, he's really interesting. He's sort of the father spokesman now. He tells the story that Tyler comes to the house, and I don't know if Tyler did this to you, but he has this piece of metal. Have you heard this story? He puts a piece of metal in Ryan's hand, and he said, okay, do you feel anything? No. And then he has a second piece of metal. He puts the second piece of metal in Tyler's hand, the same set with the other piece, and he suddenly gets this electric sort of shock up his arm. And he said, oh, okay, you've had face-to-face contact with a being. And then he gets all the rest of the family in there, and the girlfriend, nothing happens to the girlfriend, but the rest of the family all has the same sort of reaction. And when they put it in Chris Bledsoe's hand, he basically almost passes out. He sort of like really affects him really strong, which indicates that they have some sort of knowledge about a couple of little things. So that's,
yeah, they do.
Story.
This is why I told Jacques and Diana Pasulka, when you're looking at the materials, they're looking back at you. So go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, and so the other thing that happened, I met him at with Chris Bledsoe. We were at a big business guy's cabin in Pennsylvania, and it was there where he showed me his photos. And this is kind of how they do this. He shows me these photos, and he says, "What do you think of this?" And he sees two guys. They're flying through. It's a painting of these two guys. It looks like they're in pajamas, and one guy's older and the one guy's younger, and they're flying through space with these pajamas. And I said, yeah, "I don't know." And he said, what do you think? I don't know. I have no idea. And he shows me this thing with these paintings of this eclipse in different photos or different paintings, and then this painting with these balls all going in the middle. And he's showing me all this stuff, and he says, what do you think? I have no idea. I have no idea what you're talking about. And then he says, you know where it is? I said, no. He says, Hughes Aircraft Building in L.A. I said, I still don't know what you're talking about. He said, that's where the jump room was. I said, what? Let me see that. And he said, the one with the two guys flying with the pajamas was right outside of the elevator, where supposedly they had the jump room. And this is this rumored story that Obama and this jump room, they're going to Mars and all this kind of stuff. And I thought, that's totally crazy. And it wasn't until 2 years later, I'm thinking to myself, why did Tyler show me those photos? Why was he there? Why was he taking photos of these paintings? And he told me, he said, if you go there, there's a guard. Watch out for the guard. And so the first time I got to L.A., I jumped on over to 999 Sepulveda and went in the building. And sure enough, here's all the paintings that Tyler had showed me. So it was that kind of thing where you're talking in rhymes and riddles. And I don't know what he meant by it, but it was kind of weird that he would show me these photos. And the other one was, And this is one where I talk about the theory of wow, where people say, oh, you know, we've got these metals, and people are analyzing these metals and stuff, and we're going to build a flying saucer. And it's like, and I went to, even went to hell. I said, hell, come on. This is apportation. This is manifestation. And then hell says, he replies, he says, we're going to analyze the metal one step at a time. He didn't deny it, because they had, if you remember, back in the remote viewing days, when they had Uri Geller there, the story of Uri Geller is eating ice cream and he bites his lip, and there's Edgar Mitchell's Air Force pin is in his mouth and it cuts his lip. And so they go back to the lab, and the back half of the pin falls in behind Hal Putoff, and Uri Geller's in the other room, and it's this weird stuff. And that's what I was saying to Hal. Like, Hal, they're dropping this stuff. This is theory of wow. They're just dropping this stuff to make you go, wow, what's going on here? Like, what's this metal? Because you fly across the galaxy with a flying saucer or whatever. You don't suddenly have pieces falling off this thing. And you remember the thing with the memory metal, where they shot metal bullets at it and it would deflect, and you could take a sledgehammer. And yet when this thing hits the ground, it breaks into like a wine glass dropped from the fifth floor, all these little tiny pieces or whatever. So one of the stories with Tyler D was the gifting field. Well, the gifting field, it was my friend, a businessman by the name of Mark Olson here in Winnipeg, who took Tyler to the gifting field. He said, we're going to this dig here. You want to come? And Tyler said, okay. So they went there. And as soon as Tyler saw this stuff, he went, holy cow. And if you see the one piece, and I got some pieces from my friend or photographs, the one piece has a triangle on it. And triangle's a big deal. I mean, there's always stories about triangles with the intelligence. And so I actually asked Ryan, and I asked, it's in the book, Diane Pasulko's book. It's called The Gifting Field. And that's the whole idea. Are they crashing, or are they actually dropping this stuff on purpose? Is it because people think, oh, they crashed, they got hit by radar, they got hit by lightning or whatever. And then you go to the interview with Bob Bigelow that was just done with George Knapp a couple months ago. And he said, well, what about Roswell? And then Bigelow says, yeah, Roswell, yeah, but there's other crashes. There's one in Russia, there's one in China, there's one in South America. He says, I think they're seeding them. And that's exactly the idea. Are these crashes actually taking place? Or are they dropping this metal? So it's like the monkeys, you know, they drop the piece of metal and it's got this weird ice stuff, and everybody runs around and says, holy cow, look at the ice stuff on this. This is really weird. We can't possibly make that. And it's the same thing. All those sightings, everything is, oh, this is not us, which is making you think something else is going on. And I think that's all they're trying to do. They're trying to get you to wake up and realize the world is not flat. It is, the sun does not go around the earth. It is not, things are not solid. And the impression they gave me, I had one vision where they said, it's called wrong blocks. You it's like Einstein said, you cannot solve a problem using the same information that you use to create the problem. William James says, you think you're thinking, you're just rearranging your prejudices. And what they showed me was the blocks. You've got all these wrong blocks. You're shuffling all these wrong blocks around. You've got to realize some of your blocks are wrong. And what the intelligence is doing, the anomalies, is you learn from the anomalies. When something doesn't make sense, that means one of your blocks is wrong. And when you solve the anomaly, you'll move down the road in technology and science and understanding of reality.
You know, I have to tell you, Grant, this is so wonderful to listen to. Folks, listen to it twice or more than twice. Take notes, because there is so much information pouring out of Grant Cameron in this interview. I've never heard anything like it. And Grant, I've interviewed you before. I've heard many of your interviews, and you're really on a roll today, and I'm just delighted. You know, getting back, go ahead.
Well, I can mention that, and I think maybe you can verify for me, that when you first have the encounter, because I had sightings in 75, 76, and really didn't see anything after that really significant. Then 2012, I have this sort of download experience. I'm watching Colin Andrews give the lecture on crop circles, and this comes into my head. It says, this is consciousness. In 1975, because when it was flying around the second night I saw it, it came right at us the second night, came in really close. And then it just sort of made a turn, and all these people are taking pictures and swearing and yelling, and the thing just slowly flew off. And I thought, that could be ET from another planet. And then I'm thinking to myself, what's it doing? Not doing anything. And that always stuck with me. It's like, well, what are they actually doing? And that's the whole idea. It's like, why does it jump around in the sky? And it's this theory of wow thing. So when it went 2012, then 2017. Then I had this major download where I'm walking down a street, and you probably know, it's called these noetic states where it's not information. Like, you know, it's like you're talking to God or something. It's like,
right.
write this down. And you know this is right, and you quickly write it down. And if you don't, it's like a dream. You're going to forget it. And so I'm walking down the street, and this starts coming into my head, and it's cold. I take off my glove, and I start writing. And that's where they're saying, is it consciousness? Or is it you know, nuts and bolts? Is it one world? Is it random, or is it pattern? And you got this. And they say, not only have you got it wrong, it's exactly the opposite of what you think it is. And so I'm writing this stuff down. And then what I found is the more I went on, the more I started having these downloads, the more I started to get this sort of inspiration. It almost like it opens it up like the hitchhiker effect, where the more you have these, the more you open up. So I have this situation where I'm walking with a pen and piece of paper all the time. And it'll come in different ways. My main one is to walk, is to sort of shut the mind down, whereas Tyler D does the thing where he sleeps and he sits in the light and stuff like that. Or you do the sensing, which I do the sensing exercise as well. And it's the idea is to shut the left brain down. That's the whole contact modality.
Right.
Is that the left brain is causing causing noise in the signal. The signal is there. All the answers are there. Everything is there. It's your left brain. Your little voice is talking in your head and chattering away. And once you can shut that down, then you can pop into the field, grab the material, and come back. But it's so hard to shut down the left brain. So I've had these more and more of these experiences where I'm more in the field more all the time, and I get more of this information. And it's different information. It's hard to explain unless you've had it, to know what a noetic inspiration is, where you know this is how it works. It's talking to God. That's the only way I can explain it.
And that has to be the next step in the evolution of the human mind.
Yeah.
You do it. Tyler does it. A lot of people do it. A lot of people on this website do the sensing exercise, which I do. And we have to get into this level of conversation, all of us, not with our own imaginations. This is very important, but with what is really open to us. And, you know, Annie, I'm going to conclude the free part of the show with this. Said something so important. She was a brilliant woman in her life physically, and even more so afterwards. I asked her about gravity, because I'm aware of the fact that there are scientific groups working in China, the United States, Russia, and England, and I think also France, on how to solve the question of using gravity for propulsion. And I said, what about gravity, Annie? Is there anything you could tell me that would help? Because we're not getting anywhere with this. They've managed some things with manipulating the Earth's magnetic field, but nothing, not the spectacular ability to create your own gravity and do what you want within it. And she said this. She said, what they don't understand is that the universe is conscious, and the consciousness of the universe is what underlies gravity. Until you have come into contact with the yearning that created this universe, you will never understand gravity. And that's where I want to leave you, Free Dreamlanders, because we're going to talk more about this and Grant's ideas. He sent me an email before we did this interview. He wants to talk and reveal some things he knows about the 3 a.m. meditation that is so central to the whole information flow in my life that I have created. Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision with Free Dreamlanders. Thank you so much for being with us, and I have a fabulous idea. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe. But before you even do that, get started with this incredibly important voice, Grant Cameron, Contact Modalities, The Keys to the Universe. Because, you know, we watch, we listen, but when you actually read something, it gets into your mind in a whole different way. Literally, different parts of the brain are engaged, and we are in a world where our attention spans are being fractured. You got to read this. Contact Modalities by Grant Cameron. Okay, free Dreamlanders, goodbye. Subscribers, we will keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.